This is 2020, the year 2020, and Acts 2020 is a verse that actually we were going to use in our Bible conference this summer had we had it. And the idea of you get 2020 vision, that's good, perfect vision. And it's interesting that this passage, Acts 2020, is right in the middle of a part, not in the middle, but it's in a section in Acts 20 where the Apostle Paul talks about his ministry. And not just his ministry, but the ministry he's passing on to the body of Christ. And he's meeting with the Ephesian elders here. And if you wanted to see a perfect vision for what the ministry would be, a 2020 vision for what the ministry would be, this is a great passage to look at. It starts in verse 17. From Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, you know, from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you in all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility. And then he goes on to describe the ministry that he had among them. And it goes all the way down to the end of the chapter, verse 36. When he had thus spoken, he kneeled down and prayed with them all. And they all wept sore and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all for the words which he spake, that they should see his face no more. And they accompanied him unto the ship. That they would, the fact that they weren't going to see Paul anymore broke their hearts. And because they'd been very close and important to one another in the ministry. And that's what caused the whole review of what he's doing here. He was literally, he gathered these Ephesian saints there at Miletum because he didn't expect to see them again. So he wanted to prepare them. Now, Ephesus is inland. He caused them to travel. It would be like, you know, you said to somebody, look, you need to come down to St. Louis to meet me. I'm going to be in town. And the elders went there to meet with him. He was wanting to prepare them for the work of the ministry in his absence. And if you look at verse 28, you can see why this what the problem is. Take heed unto yourselves and to the flock, to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. The first responsibility of the local assembly and the pastors and leaders of the local assembly is to feed the church of God. We'll see a verse in a minute in Timothy, that godly edifying which is in faith. Nourish them up in good words and sound doctrine so that they're strong and able to be mature. That's the cardinal requirement of a local church, the cardinal purpose in ministering a local church. The reason he says that's verse 29. For I know this, that after my departing, and they're not going to see him again, so he's trying to prepare them from being away. I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. So they're going to have predators that attack them, and they don't spare them. They're going to try to destroy them, tear them up. And also, verse 30, of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after themselves. So there's going to be an external attack of wolves predators coming in and trying to destroy the church. And then in the midst of the church, there are going to be these Diotrephes that rise up to draw away disciples after themselves. They're not interested in the work of the ministry. They're not interested in getting people to follow Christ. They're interested in building a religious following and machinery. And so there's going to be an internal defection. So you get, in Corinthians, he says, there were fightings without and fears within. The ministry is going to be that way, guys, and you need to be prepared for the danger that comes against, is going to come against you. Hold your hand here and come with me to 1 Timothy chapter 1. This is some years later when he sends Timothy to Ephesus. By the time Timothy gets there in 1 Timothy, all the things that he'd warned him about have come to pass. And so he sends Timothy there because of the Ephesian church. When Timothy gets there, it's not a new church plant. It's a long, older, seasoned church with a lot of problems. They've been attacked from without. They've got the folks drawing away people from within. 1 Timothy 1, verse 3, I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia. Now, we've studied 1 Timothy, and I showed you that when there's no record of Paul doing that anywhere in the book of Acts. So this had to have taken place after the book of Acts, which means in Acts 28 he's in prison. He's released from prison, does some ministry, this part of it, and then he gets put back into prison, and he writes 2 Timothy. So this is literally after the close of the book of Acts. So the Ephesian church has been there for a long time. They've had plenty of time to have problems. So Paul says, I left you there, Timothy, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. So some people have come up teaching other doctrines. Neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions, rather than godly edifying, which is in faith. There's the feed the church, the godly edifying. Take the saints and mature them so they can fight off the predators and identify the self-seekers. Now, the end of the commandment, if you'll do what I'm telling you, if you'll feed the church, you give yourself to godly edification, don't change the doctrine, don't pay attention, all this stuff, the end of the commandment is charity. Now, I've told you before, everybody wants charity. Everybody wants somebody to love everybody. If you want charity in the assembly, you don't get it by not talking about the doctrine. You get it by teaching the doctrine and by maintaining the doctrine. You get it by godly edifying. When you charity is the bond of perfectness, Colossians says. The way you have charity is by the sound doctrine edifying the believer. You're able to value and esteem the thing the way God sees it. You're able to look at it the way God looks at it. You have that renewed mind. And that gives you the ability, that comes from that godly edifying. So the end of godly edification, the result, is charity out of a pure heart, one single-minded heart, and of a good conscience, and of faith unfeigned, from which some having swerved. So there's some people there's some people in the assembly who've left sound doctrine, turned aside into vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding what they say, whereof they affirm. So you've got some people in the assembly here who are doing exactly what he said back in Acts 20. They've gone away into false. They're still using the Bible. They haven't abandoned the Bible, but they're not rightly dividing the Bible. The law is the Bible, but it's not the Bible rightly divided. So they've gone back into an old dispensational program rather than standing in the truth that Paul gave them, and it's resulted in confusion. And Paul's telling Timothy, in the church, you need to be sure that you focus on maintaining the doctrine. And when people come in with something that's other than that, then you have to deal with it. If you look over at 2 Timothy, it even gets worse. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. This thou knowest, that all they which are in Asia be turned away from me. So now Asia is where Ephesus was, this modern-day Turkey. Asia Minor, we call it. And those different churches that Paul had established in there have abandoned. Where did they turn to? Well, you read in 1 Timothy, they went back under the law. They haven't turned their back on the Lord. They've turned their back on Paul. You see it in chapter 2, verse number 18, talking verse 17. And their word will eat doth the canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past. Already, and overthrow the faith of some. So they departed from Paul, and consequently, concerning the truth, they've erred because they can't get the resurrection in the proper dispensational place. So when you depart from Paul, you wind up not being able to understand anything about your Bible. The right division's gone. Chapter 3, verse 8. For as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the truth. So you see the progression. They leave Paul. They don't understand right division. They can't understand the Bible. They can't get things in the right place. So they quit that. And now they resist being corrected by the truth. In chapter 4, it says they turn their ears and won't listen to sound doctrine. They're just completely gone. So that path of apostasy has metastasized in 2 Timothy to the place where when you begin reading church history, 2 Timothy is the last book written in your Bible, where the church quote, fathers begin is in total apostasy. If you go back and read church history, the Antinician fathers, probably 10, 12 feet long, the volume of books of all these Antinician fathers. You can read them in and out, in and out, in and out, and they're just, you say, what in the world is that about? It's complete confusion about salvation, about the Christian life, about just about everything. And there's a guy one time a few years ago wrote a book, The Strange Teachings of the Church Fathers. And it was just a compilation of all the different things that they taught. And he was saying, look at all the different things they taught. We love them anyway. So it really doesn't matter what you teach about these things. If you're off base, you can love everybody anyway. And I thought, that's a weird way to write a book. It didn't sell very well, but according to him. But it is true. Well, the reason for that, and the reason you don't go to the church fathers, you go to the Bible, is because they were apostate when they started. So it's not unusual. I mean, no wonder by 100 or 125, you have people in trying to establish a kingdom. No wonder in the second and third century, you know, you wind up with Rome and control and so forth. They didn't have the life that you and I understand. Now, there were people like us still faithful. When he says all that in Asia have turned against me, well, Timothy hadn't. So it's a general statement, not an absolute statement. There is a believing remnant there, but it's always that remnant mentality. So when Paul talks about these things, if you want to go back to, well, stay there in 2 Timothy 3. I didn't get to the verse I wanted. Verse 10. In spite of all that, but thou, in spite of what they do, Timothy, here's what you need to do. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. He's going back to Acts 13 to get those. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all they that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in those things. You see how he does that? He says, that's how bad it's going to be, but you stick with the stuff. It's going to be like that, but you know my doctrine. It's going to be men departing, deceiving, being deceived, waxing worse and worse. But thou, so you and I, the contrast, in spite of the apostasy, in spite of the dereliction, in spite of the attacks, the wolves coming in, the defections from within, stick by the stuff, he says. And he says in verse 10, you've known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith. His ministry is the pattern that we're to follow. And a great picture of his ministry is that he gives it in Acts chapter 20. So what my point in all that is, if you want to understand a vision, a proper vision, or a perfect vision, if you want to say that, an Acts 20:20 vision for the ministry, this is a good place to go, because you're going to need to be steadfast against the false doctrine. And Paul says that what you need to know, you know how I've done the ministry, and I'm your pattern, so go look at that. So if you come back to Acts 20, I just want to go through a couple of these verses, not all of them, but some of these things that Paul talks about right here at the beginning, where he talks about what I guess you could call the parameters or the dimensions of the ministry. Verse 19, 2019, or verse 2018, and when they were come to him, he said unto them, you know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you in all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying weight of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I go bound in my spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. That's a little summary that Paul gives of what he's been doing. And he starts off in verse 19, and he says, you know that what I've been doing is serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by lying in wait of the Jews. When Paul looked at the ministry, the first thing he thought about it is he was serving the Lord. This is God's work. It's not his. It's not a denomination's. It's not an organization's. When you do the work of the ministry, you're not doing something for yourself. You're not building you a little kingdom and a following and that kind of thing, a little empire. It's God's work. That verse in 1 Corinthians 3 says, we're laborers together with God. You're God's husbandry. You're God's building. You're literally God's garden, a husbandry. You're his building, his edifice. And we labor with God to build it. When you get away from understanding that the work you're doing in the work of the ministry, you're serving the Lord Christ. You're not serving yourself, your reputation. You're not serving a religious institution, a denomination. That'll help you not get into the kingdom organization machinery building business. You just belong to the Lord. And that was Paul's mindset about it. That's the mindset to have. Verse 20, and how I kept nothing back that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and taught you publicly and from house to house. As far as the church was concerned, Paul taught God's word to them clearly. You're going to come back. He fully communicated. We'll come back to that in just a minute. Verse 21, testifying both to the Jews and the Greeks. That's the lost people. So first he recognizes his ministry. He's serving the Lord. He knows what to do with the church. You teach him. And then he looks out to the lost people. Why would he do that? God's will is to have all men saved, come to the knowledge of the truth. So he's looking at lost people, and he's testifying to the Jews and to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Now when he says repentance toward God, they don't know God. If you look back at chapter 17, verse 30, the time of this ignorance God winked at. Now, the ignorance, if you look back to what the ignorance was, back in verse 22, then Paul, he's in Mars Hill in Athens. And you see verse 16, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. He looked out and he saw all that worship of false gods, and he couldn't keep his mouth shut. So he says to them in verse 22, ye men of Athens, I perceive in all things you are too superstitious. When I tell people their religious system is superstitious, that's the verse I'm talking about. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you. So they are worshiping they are ignorantly worshiping, and they don't know who God is. They don't know who they're worshiping. And so they're ignorant about who God is. So in verse, that's the condition of the Gentiles. Well, verse 30, the time of this ignorance of God, they're ignorant of God, that time passed. The time of this ignorance God winked at. But now with the dispensation of grace, now with the revelation of salvation to all men through faith alone in Christ, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. So repentance, change your mind about this ignorance. You don't know who God is, change your mind. Learn who he is and trust the true and living God. You look at 1 Thessalonians 1, 9, that's what they did. They turned from idols to serve the living and true and living God. That's repentance. And that's what Paul's doing. He's in a pagan world. A lot of folks, you know, through my ministry, people have asked about that. Well, why would he do that? Because it's been true for most of us in our experience, probably half of you anyway, age-wise, that you would go out into the culture and people knew who God was, the God of the Bible. They might not believe in him, probably didn't, but at least they knew who Jesus was, and you know, and that kind of thing. Now you go out on the streets and you don't find that. Now you go out on the streets and it's harder to find somebody that knows who the God of the Bible is than it is than it isn't. It's more rare. Our culture is completely swapped over. And now you can talk to people, and I do this. You can go out on the street corner and talk to people and ask them, do you have any concept of God? And they've got all kind of, I call it the gospel according to Oprah. It's okay, it's good to be in touch with your spiritual side. I ask them, do you ever think about spiritual things? Oh, yes, we think about spiritual things all the time. Well, what do you think? Well, you know, there's, and then they're going, it's going kind of the app frame, you know, out here looking around, don't know where anything is. They don't know some basic things. The world you and I are going into is going to be a completely paganized society, very much like the one Paul lived in. If you can imagine that. We've lived in a Christendom, a world that's been cleaned up and structured up and you know, brought up in a form of Christianity that cleaned. Listen, it's nicer. I read that passage in Romans 1 this morning about what happens when you give yourself over to a reprobate mind, that list of really bad things. And that makes a nasty world to live in. Malice, hating, hateful, you know, all those terrible things. And that it's not safe to walk down the streets in a community practicing that stuff. Well, people have come in and put in Christian values, Bible values, and it's kind of clean. So they kind of cleaned up the culture. Sure, we're Christians. Because why? Well, we're not pagans. Why not? Well, look how we act. And it's nicer to live in a nice neighborhood. I'm talking about nice behaving neighborhood. That's not the world Paul lived in. He lived in a perilous time. Because the even the religious structures, well, that stuff's over with us. And you're going to see a world that's so completely different than it has been. But remember, it's going to be like the world Paul lived in. It's not, you know, I'm not being hopeless. I'm just being realistic. The hope's in the gospel. And the truth is in the gospel. And the world Paul lived in was not a comfortable world for a believer to live in. Now, he went out among the lost people and preached, hey, that's not God. The Bible, God's God. And you need to change your mind about it. And then he preached faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to put your faith in him. Why? Because, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifest. Even the righteousness of God, which is said by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there's no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood. To do what? To declare at this time his righteousness, that he might be just and justify them which believe in Jesus. God's got an answer for your sin. He has an answer for your lostness. He has an answer for your weariness. He has an answer for your anger and your hatred and your maliciousness and your bigotry. He has answers for that, and it's all in his Son. So he would point them toward the true and living God and the answer that he put. He ministered the gospel to the lost. He's out there teaching the gospel, out there confronting them. Then in verse 22, and now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit. Now he's going to talk about himself. So he looked at the ministry as serving the Lord. He looked at the importance of ministering to the body of Christ, making them strong so they could do the work of the ministry of getting the gospel out. And then he talked about himself. Because no matter what you do in the ministry, it all comes down to the fact that you're doing the ministry. And why are you doing what you're doing? Why do you want to do what's right? And he says, I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem. Now, when he said that, a lot of people get mad at him because he says, I don't know what's going to happen to me there, except the Holy Spirit witnesses that in every city, saying bonds and affliction abide me. And people say, well, I'll say he shouldn't have went. He shouldn't have went. God, the Holy Spirit trying to tell him not to go. But she said he's bound in the Spirit. He had a compulsion in his heart. He was compelled by this commitment that he had to do what verse 24 says, to fulfill his ministry. And he was willing to sacrifice himself. And by the way, the Holy Spirit never told him not to go. The Holy Spirit told him, if you go, this is what's going to happen. Now, that's a different thing. Because if he tells him, if you go and this is going to happen, bonds and afflictions are going to await you there, and he goes anyway, he was willing to take the bonds and afflictions. That's why it says in verse 24, but none of those things move me. Neither count I my life dear unto myself. And boy, that's a hard statement. Because most of us count our lives pretty dear unto ourselves. You know, we take care of ourselves pretty good. And we don't like to stick our neck out too far. And Paul says, none of those things, my life, my possessions, my reputation, they weren't really the things that I held the most dear. Why? So that I might finish my course. I mean, I know what the Lord Jesus Christ called me to. He called me to testify the gospel of the grace of God. He gave me a ministry unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I might preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what's the fellowship of the ministry. Paul said, I know I've been made the apostle. I'm the apostle of the Gentiles. I magnify my office. I know who I am. I know what I'm doing. I know what I've been called to do. Every epistle he wrote, he said, Paul, he knew who he was. And he said, nothing is more dear to me, more precious to me than that. And that personal commitment, that ability, the capacity, the willingness to be bound in the Spirit, to have that be compelled by that commitment, that personal commitment and willingness of sacrificing himself, those are the things that, in Paul's mind, purpose-driven ministry, the vision that he had for the ministry. And if you go back to verse 20, to do the 2020 deal, now how I kept back nothing that was profitable for you, but have showed you and taught you publicly and from house to house. In every forum, I taught you. Completely given, fully teaching God's word to God's people. And he says, I taught you, whether it's publicly, house to house, everything we did focused on helping the believer to be edified. We didn't have entertainment sessions. We didn't have bake sales to gain, you know, raise money. We weren't trying. We didn't have chicken dinners. We weren't having concerts and hootenannies. We got together to study and to edify ourselves in God's word and in God's truth. And it says, I kept nothing back from you. And the two things there, I kept nothing back that was profitable. If you look down at verse 25, now behold, I go, behold, I know that you all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. And that's what got him upset. And by the way, when he went around preaching the kingdom of God, he's not preaching what Jesus and John the Baptist preached in Mark and Matthew. Paul added a component to the kingdom of God that was a secret, that wasn't a part of the prophetic program message about the kingdom of God. I've been trying to say to you when we studied Mark on Wednesday night that the people, Israel, had a clear understanding that their kingdom program was a literal, physical, visible, earthly kingdom. What they were missing is there was a spiritual element to it. And they understood that they were going to be that God had made a promise to Abraham that he would use Abraham's seed to restore the headship of Christ over the earth vested in that kingdom given to Israel. Paul came along and says, you know, that kingdom isn't just going to be on the earth. There's a branch of it up in the heavens. There's a family of God on the earth and a family of God that's going to be in the heavens. When he created thrones, dominions, principalities, and powers in the earth for himself, he also created them in the heavens. And now he has an agency to reclaim the government there, just like he can reclaim it on the earth. And so when Paul preached about it, he added the further component of the mystery program. Peter's preaching that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began, how Christ would come back and establish his kingdom, restored on the earth. Paul's preaching Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest about a body he's going to use to exalt his headship in the heavens. Then you have one kingdom, heaven and earth, under one head. So don't read that and think that Paul was preaching what Peter preached. Too often he tells you he isn't. But he's preaching a further component in what God's doing. Verse 26, wherefore I take you to record, since you know I've been preaching, I take you to record. And by the way, the book of Acts is written focused on the nation Israel. That's why he will use a lot of Israel's terminology to make Israel understand, hey, your program's now in the hand of, your program's been set aside and your God is over there working with Paul. Verse number 26, wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you the counsel of God. That's what he's talking about when he said back there, I've kept back nothing. I've given you the complete, total package of what God's word says. And then he says, I kept back nothing that was profitable. Now, when something is profitable, come over to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. What he's talking about there is the process by which you produce what Timothy called, what he said in Timothy, is godly edifying. There is a growth process for a believer where you go from a baby to an adult. You go from taking in milk to strong meat. If you are a baby, it's not profitable to give you strong meat. There's a process, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6. Howbeit we speak wisdom, start back in verse 1. And I, brethren, could not, when I came unto you, came not with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now, a lot of people use that as their life verse. But Paul was not complimenting them when he said that. He was saying, all I could do is give you the basic elements of the cross work, because that's all you could bear. But in verse 6, it says, howbeit, we speak wisdom among them which are perfect. We go on with further truth among people that are mature, grown up. Come over to chapter 3. And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual. I couldn't talk to you like you were an adult. I couldn't speak wisdom, the advanced things, the grown-up things to you. Why? But as unto carnal, even as unto babes, I fed you with milk and not with meat. For hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able. So there's a process. And he was giving to the saints what was profitable, what they need. He wasn't just giving them what he wanted to do. I find that one of the most fascinating things in preaching. You can either preach what you want to preach, or you can preach what people need. I've been in meetings with people, travel long distances to meetings, and watch people preach, and there'd be preaching to people I didn't know who they were. And I'm watching the preachers who did know the people, and they're preaching messages, and I'm thinking, how is that message profitable in this situation? Now, I can't say it wasn't, I don't know, but it just didn't make sense to me that it be what's profitable. And Paul said, I was able to, I understood you, I knew you, I knew what you needed. I didn't talk over your head, I didn't talk under your feet. I gave you what was going to be a profitable in your edification. In other words, he's giving himself to godly edifying. That's what the local church does. When Proverbs says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he won't depart, that's not telling a parent, well, you just train the child, tell him what to do, do this, don't do that, don't do that, and then when he's old, he'll do what you tell him. He's telling, that verse is saying, train up the child in the way he should go. You need to understand a dad's first responsibility in his home with his children is to know his kids. Get to know them, play with them, learn, spend time with them. Know them so well that you understand their personality. You understand their weaknesses. And you train them how to live and their identity in Christ in those things. And when you've trained them that way, when they're grown, that's how they'll know how to live. I was talking with someone earlier today. We were talking about the importance of having a dad in the home. You know, there are countless homes today that don't have men, don't have dad in the home. And if you wonder what happens to cultures when dad isn't in the home and mom, and if you have a whole community where dad isn't there in most of the homes, it'll wind up being grandma raising the kids. It just turns out, you watch it. Now you've got a child raised in a home by grandma or by mother and no dad. Where's dad? He's down on the street corner. He's off in the field. But think about it, dad doesn't have a home to come to. If he isn't in the home, where's home? There's his wife, the mother of his child, there's his child, there's home, but he's not there. Well, where is he? Well, he's off over here, and what he winds up is down on the street corner, down at the bar, or down in the park, and when it comes time to go home, when it gets dark, where are you going to go tonight? You're going to go home. What if you didn't have a home to go to? Your home's, you say, well, I'll go over here. Yeah, but he knows his home's there. And he's an outcast. So now you've got men who are totally lost their ability to be men. And you've got homes, children, that never learn how to function under an authority figure. Listen, mom can tell you, go to school, do your homework, behave yourself all day long, and kids say, she loves me. Dad says, sit down, shut up, and get the homework done. He means it. Now, that's an illustration, okay? In Kyle's case, that's probably not the way it works, right? But that's a generalization. But you get there is a responsibility that a dad has in a home. That when it isn't there, it's lost. It's a sad thing. And it has effects, and I'm not talking about just in individual homes, but it has effect in cultures. And when you see that and you see them disintegrate, you see that and you say, wow, that growing process. And Paul said, I understand that for the local church, for the believers. Come with me for to the book of Colossians, chapter 1. I just read you through a passage. When I think of Paul's ministry and of his thinking about the ministry, this passage of Colossians 1 is probably my favorite passage to ruminate over Paul's thinking. Colossians chapter 1, verse 24. You see, in the end of verse 23, it says, whereof I, Paul, was made a minister, talking about every creature under heaven, who now rejoice in my suffering for you, and fill up that which is behind in the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church. Notice he talks about the sufferings like he was talking in Acts 20, 24. None of these things count my life dear to myself that I might fit. Here he says, I rejoice in my sufferings. His attitude about the ministry was one of joy, in spite of the fact that it cost him personally, in spite of the fact there were sacrifices, things he didn't do that he could have otherwise done. He said, I'm excited about it. There's a joy in my soul about the value of what I'm doing. The church whereof I am made a minister. How's he made a minister? According to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery. Now, where did he get his ministry? He got it from God. He knew that he wasn't serving a religious system. He knew he was serving the living and the true God. You go back there, I'm serving the Lord. Verse number 26, here's the subject of what he ministered, the word of God that he ministered, even the mystery, which had been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Paul understood that the subject that he was preaching was Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, he preached the mystery, the dispensational distinctiveness of it, because it was there that the glory of Christ in you, the hope of glory, the riches of that is made known. So Paul understood that he's preaching the riches of God's grace, the riches of God's glory. And the thing that captivated him was that, Christ in you, Christ out there among you Gentiles, the hope of glory, whom we preach. Now here's the summation of it. Whom we preach. By the way, it's who, not what. When he preached the sound doctrine, he was preaching a living person, the living Word of God. This is not just catechism. Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man. Every man ministry for everybody, no distinctions. Warning them, that'll get you in trouble. Teaching them, here's how to get out of it. Here's what God says, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. The goal is the perfection of the believer. The goal is the perfecting of the saint, because it's the perfected saint that does the work of the ministry. So you have verse number 29, whereunto I labor, striving according to his mighty working, which worketh in me mightily. There's where the strength is. It's the perfected saint doing the work of the ministry and the strength to do the work of the ministry. And that thing when he says, striving according to his working, wherefore I labor. That concept of labor there is the idea as I work and labor to the point of exhaustion, where I just fall out. I walked around the lobby last night as the folks were about finished cleaning up after the wedding, and I'm looking at some of the ladies, and I thought of that verse. I said, some of these ladies have labored to the point of exhaustion. 3 days you get this thing, and labor and work ceaselessly and push and do. And Paul said, you know, I labor to the point of exhaustion, striving, but it's his work that gave energy to me. So none of these things count out my life due to myself. Come to 2 Timothy 4. That I might finish my course with joy. So in 2 Timothy 4, he says in verse number 6, for I'm ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. The thing that he strived after, the goal that he pressed toward, he said, I finished the course. I did the job. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. When you live for him, you focus on him, you keep eternity in view, you finish the course. He said there's a reward in that. There's something that comes at the end of the day that brings ultimate honor and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul sets himself up as an example for Timothy to follow, for the Ephesian elders to follow, for us, to be our example. He says in chapter 2, the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall teach others also. So if you want to have a clear vision of what ministry is about in the dispensation of grace, if you want to be 20/20 in your spiritual ministry vision, your example sits right there in your scripture for you. You can contemplate that, look at that, let that be the pattern of your life, and measure yourself by the pattern God gives you to measure by. Not the world, not religion, not self, not your flesh, but God's Word. Father, we thank you tonight for your Word, for the opportunity to be here and fellowship around it with these folks. And we just pray that our time together in it, in your Word, might stir in our hearts the joy of being able to serve you because of our soon coming Savior. In his name, amen. Okay, praise the Lord.